Parkinson's affects dopamine. Dopamine is a neurotransmitter, which is a messenger in the brain and body. Anything that upsets the balance of these chemical messengers can affect the brain.
Parkinson's affects thinking that has to do with planning, starting and finishing tasks and actions, and making sense of what you see around you, and organizing and getting to memories, language, and attention.
With Parkinson's, you can't think as quickly, and your thinking can become less flexible. More than half of all Parkinson's patients have depression, feeling sad or blue. It often comes with anxiety, feeling nervous and worried.
It can be one of the earliest signs of Parkinson's, showing up many years before you know you have the disease. Sadness and worry may be caused by fewer chemicals in your brain that make you feel happy. It can also be because of something that is happening in your life, like stress at work or a new health problem.
In Parkinson's disease, it's probably caused by both chemical changes in the brain and having an ongoing health problem. Sometimes the person with Parkinson's is grumpy and unhappy with life. It is important to know the signs of depression and get help.
These signs may include a change in mood, loss of interest in things you usually do, feeling very guilty, too much or too little sleep, less interest in food, weight loss, fear, and worry, not feeling good about yourself, feeling very tired, less interest in sex, and thoughts of suicide, which are rare in Parkinson's.
Anxiety can really get in the way of living. It's an uneasy feeling of fear or worry without a clear reason why. It can turn into a full-on panic attack. The first thing is to see if sadness or worry come when your Parkinson's medicine is wearing off. If they do, then a change in Parkinson's medicine may help. Antidepressant medicine can help too.
Dopamine is the chemical in your brain that makes you feel inspired to do things. Without this chemical, you may feel apathy. Apathy is a lack of interest in or concern for things that others find moving or exciting.
It is being emotionally flat. Lack of interest may not mean you're sad or don't care about things. It could be apathy. Apathy is hard to treat.
It often upsets family and friends more than the person with Parkinson's. Talk therapy can help with sadness and worry. One form of therapy, cognitive behavioral therapy, or CBT, helps people change the way they think about their life and their health problems.
CBT, meditation, mindfulness, exercise, daylight, volunteering, healthy eating, and seeing friends are all helpful.
Life partners and other family members should get their own mental health care and join a support group. They need help to better cope with their loved one's sadness, worry, or apathy. People who support the person with Parkinson's need to care for themselves first. If they aren't well, they can't be there for their loved one. This takes a mind shift for some people. Self-care is not selfish care.
In mid-stage Parkinson's, some patients may begin to see, hear, or feel things that aren't there.
At first, it may be thinking an object is something else, an illusion. For example, a mailbox may look like a child playing in the yard. Seeing something that is not there is called a hallucination. Visual hallucinations are the most common type of hallucination in Parkinson's.
Usually, the person is aware the hallucination isn't real. It's usually not scary. Both Parkinson's and the medicine used to treat Parkinson's can cause hallucinations. For example, some may see shadows moving out of the corner of their eye.
They may sense that someone is in the room with them. An object may look like an animal. They see a small, furry creature skittering by out of the corner of their eye. It's important to tell your doctor about this if it happens to you.
Medicines for Parkinson's can make life better. But sometimes, a side effect of medicines can make you do things that are a problem. It's important to know what to look out for so you can tell your doctor.
Punting is handling, putting together, taking apart, collecting, or sorting objects over and over. There is no goal in mind and no reason for these actions. Dopamine dysregulation syndrome is when a person with Parkinson's does things that are like being addicted.
It can be caused by the medicines that replace dopamine. A person may take more and more of the medicine beyond what they need, even though it has harmful side effects.
When the person's dose is wearing off, they may feel very uneasy, unhappy, angry, and unhinged, like they can't go on. It's a strong mental need for the medicine.
Impulse control disorders are when you can't stop doing something that is harmful to yourself or others. Impulse control disorders, or ICDs, may be a side effect of levodopa.
But they happen more often with dopamine agonists like pramipexole or mirapex, ropinirole or requip, and retigotine patch or nupro. One in six patients taking dopamine agonists may develop ICDs.
People who have had DBS are also at risk. The most common ICDs include too much shopping, eating, gambling, and thinking about sex all the time. It can also mean doing other things too much, like being overboard on an interest or hobby.
ICDs may start out as mild and then slowly get out of control. The person may not see that what is happening is a problem. ICDs may start soon after starting a dopamine agonist, or they may not appear until a person has been on this for 2 to 5 years. Then they begin to do things that may seem harmless, like shopping for a new item when they already have 10 just like it.
A red flag should go up if you find yourself wanting to hide something from your loved ones. It's very important for family and friends to point out problems to the person with Parkinson's and their doctor. These types of actions become a problem over time. Seeking help as soon as the person starts doing these things, not later.
We don't know fully why ICDs happen, but we do know that dopamine affects the brain's pleasure and reward centers. The dopamine agonist can make reward centers too active. This may teach the brain to want rewards.
Keep a drug diary. Write down changes in your mood and actions and how your body feels. If you start to do any of the things mentioned or doing things that you feel guilty about, talk to someone about it. Don't wait. This isn't your fault. Let your family know what's happening because the problem affects them too.
Changes in sex life are common in Parkinson's, even though people are embarrassed to talk about it. People with health issues have sex lives too. There's no reason to keep it secret. In 2008, the World Health Organization said that sexual health is important to quality of life.
Not only does sex make the quality of your life better, but it also improves thinking. There are many Parkinson's symptoms that affect sex life. Trouble with erections, tremor, less desire, dry vagina, trouble having an orgasm, and low testosterone are common issues. People rarely feel more sexual desire. Having a lot more sex or desire may be a side effect from the Parkinson's medicines. Trouble with moving, like stiffness and slowness, as well as feeling sad, feeling worried, feeling bad about the way your body looks, and side effects of medicines like antidepressants can all affect sex life.
Other health issues like diabetes, high cholesterol, smoking, thyroid disease, and heart disease can also make the problem worse. There are ways to treat these problems. Look for a sex therapist through the American Association of Sexuality Educators, Counselors, and Therapists, aasec.org. Couples counseling can also help.
See your urologist or gynecologist for help. Use lubricants like KY jelly or estrogen creams. Use massage oil to help with stiffness and tremor. Medicate and plan accordingly so that you are on when you need to be.
Be creative. If you wear a dust glove, it may feel good to your partner if you have a bad tremor. A pillow wedge can help with positioning. Rethink sex. It doesn't always have to be the same activities. A well-known sex therapist, Gyla Bronner, says sex is like a meal. When you come to my house for a meal, you don't always have to have all four courses. Touch, hugging, and massage also feel good and help you feel close to your partner. They also make chemicals in your brain that can lessen pain.
Friends and family and the person with Parkinson's may feel deep sadness or grief over the losses that come with the disease. These losses are not as clear as other types of losses. They are losses that don't have an end. They may not be thought of as a loss by someone else.
Examples are loss of dreams for the future, independence, privacy, knowing that you have enough money, family roles, social life, hobbies, and a career.
Parkinson's is a hard journey. It means showing up every day, looking at what's happening, and trying to find meaning. This can be hard because often it's work or hobbies that give our lives meaning. Not being able to do these things can make the sense of loss even bigger.
This journey can feel lonely. Connecting with others can help you cope. See and accept the pain that comes with loss, but also make changes so that you can live with these losses.
Your family or care partner is dealing with their own losses too. Working with a therapist, friend, or others who can guide and support you can be helpful.
Tools to help you and your family process the disease and the changes it brings include family talks where everyone can say how the disease is affecting them, talking with a social worker about ways to get help, your doctor can connect you with one, addressing grief and loss with a therapist, building on your family's strengths, attending a support group. Your doctor can connect you with one.
Looking at websites like Parkinson.org, APDAParkinson.org, MichaelJFox.org, and DavisFinneyFoundation.org.
Care partners often ask how they can best help their loved one. The number one thing you can do is take care of yourself first. Self-care is not selfish care.
Take care of your own health. Keep up with your interests and friends. Only after making sure your own needs are met can you help others. When care partners are not well, the entire family suffers.
Go to the doctor with your loved one. Help get ready for doctor visits and talk with the doctor between visits. Have your loved one sign a form that lets the doctor talk about their health with you. Make sure you are listed as a contact. Help watch how the medicines are working. See if there are side effects that need to be looked at. It's helpful to take notes and share them with the care team.
Make note of signs like your loved one feeling very sad or a tremor, stiffness, or slowness getting worse. Note when these things happen in relation to when they take their Parkinson's medications. Help make a chart for your loved one's medicine. Your loved one may be taking many different medicines at different times. Offer to help them stay on track by making a chart. Help set alarms for when to take medicines.
Learn more about Parkinson's. Knowledge is power for you too. Learning more about the disease will help you get ready to help the person with Parkinson's.
It will help quiet your fears. It will help you to ask for the right care at the right time for your loved one.
Contact the APDA or the Parkinson's Foundation. There is so much to learn. The information and help are there. Change how you communicate. Parkinson's disease affects attention, decision-making, planning, and finishing tasks. Talks and questions should be focused and direct. Say, should we go for a picnic or eat at Sarah's diner? Instead of open-ended questions like, where should we go for dinner?
Write down important messages. Look your loved ones in the eye when you're talking. Don't try to talk from another room or with your back turned. Talk at a slower pace. Make sure the person with Parkinson's has time to reply. They may take longer to think about what you said and come up with the words to answer. Listen to them carefully. Look for cues and meaning.
When they write to you, ignore any spelling and grammar mistakes. If you understand their message, that's good enough.
They may get frustrated trying to get their point across. Urge them to keep trying. Use body signals that you both understand, like a head nod or a thumbs up.
Get involved in research with your loved one. Parkinson's research studies need people without the disease as a control group. This can bring new meaning into your lives. Call our clinic if you want to learn more about the Parkinson's disease studies at the University of Minnesota.